Good morning. Hey, last week we started this series called Different, A Study of the Life of Daniel. If you know anything about the life of Daniel, it's a pretty amazing life, but it was a pretty challenging situation he found himself in. And what I want to caution you is if you are familiar with the life of Daniel, you have sometimes there's a danger, if anytime something's familiar to you, to tune out. And I think God always has new perspective and sometimes even new truth that he wants to bring into your life. So be careful if you're familiar with the life of Daniel. There's more there than you think. If you're not familiar with the life of Daniel, great, this is perfect. We're looking at his life. It's recorded in the Old Testament book of Daniel, and it tells us about his life spanning about a 65 to 70-year period where he encountered some amazing challenges. One day, Daniel woke up, and everything was different than he thought it was going to be. The Babylonian Empire, led by their field general Nebuchadnezzar, who would eventually succeed his dad as king, came into town, conquered the town, and just started chaos and havoc for everybody in the nation of Judah and in the city of Jerusalem. And Daniel found himself in that group. They were the reigning superpower, and they were kind of having their way with the world. And suddenly they came into Jerusalem, and they took stuff from the temple as trophies. Stuff that was meaningful in their worship, they treated as trinkets to put in their trophy case. But they didn't just take stuff when they left Jerusalem. They took people as hostages, as trophies from their battle. And one of the people they took was Daniel and some of his friends. Over the course of time, they would take as many as 10,000 who would be displaced from their home and have to live in Babylon. Well, Daniel found himself in a different place with different plans, with a different king and a different life than he thought. And the Babylonians, they kind of gave him a scholarship to Babylon University, where he did not want to go there. And the whole goal was, we want to make Daniel and his friends and anybody that becomes one of our hostages or one of our trophies from spoils of war, we want to make them think like us, act like us, believe like us, talk like us, live like us. We want to make Daniel become like a Babylonian. They changed their names, which was very significant. Their names meant something about their relationship to God. Every one of their names, they changed their names, changed their diet, tried to change their beliefs. But what they couldn't do is change who they were, because Daniel and his friends had a different kind of resolve. They were going to be defined by God. Their difference was going to be defined by God and empowered by God, and they stuck to their resolve. Most people who did that died under King Nebuchadnezzar. Daniel and his friends didn't. And I think it's because they had a very different approach. If you have your Bible, turn to Daniel chapter 2. And we're going to look how he had a different approach that I would challenge you. This is the approach that we need to have, the mindset. We need to have a different mindset and a different approach in life if we want to be someone where our difference makes a difference. Daniel chapter 2, verse 1, it says this. In the second year of his reign, Nebuchadnezzar had dreams. His mind was troubled, and he could not sleep. There's something comforting about this, that the man who is the most powerful man in the world suddenly has bad dreams and can't sleep and realize, I'm not as in control as I think I am. Here's the truth about anybody and everybody. No matter how much power, success, control, resources you have, eventually something will come along in your life and remind you, you are not as in control as you think you are. It's kind of comforting, but it's also kind of concerning, because that'll happen to us at some point. And it disturbs our worldview where we think, I've got this. No, you don't. Well, he's so disturbed by his dream that he decides, I need someone to help me understand this. So he calls in all of his wise men, his advisors, the highest people in his wise man. He had a lot of wise men in his command. And they were people that could do anything that he thought could give him divine and supernatural insight. Magicians, astrologers, sorcerers, I mean, anybody he can find. And he said, I want you to be my advisors. So he calls to his advisors. He goes, I've had a really bad dream, and I'm pretty sure it's not bad pizza from the night before. I think somebody's trying to tell me something, and I don't know what it is. And they go, great, we can help you with that. And he says, okay, I want you to tell me what my dream means, because I'm so disturbed by it. But here's the thing. So I know that your insight is divine insight. I don't want you to just tell me what the dream means. I want you to tell me what the dream is. No. Like, tell us what the dream is, we'll interpret it. No, if you have divine insight, you tell me what I dreamed, and then tell me what it means. And he gives this challenge. you tell me what it is and what it means. You're going to be rich beyond belief and powerful beyond belief. I'm going to give you so much stuff. But if you get it wrong, you're going to die. I mean, this is the first get rich or die trying like mentality. Like this is it. Like, it's all or nothing here. Tell me what the dream is. Tell me what it means. And they go, no. Pretty please tell us what it is, and we'll tell you what it means. And it makes him angry. He says, no, again, you can get rich or die trying. Tell me what the dream is, and then tell me what it means. And they respond this way. They say this. The astrologers answered the king, there is no one on earth who can do what the king asks. No king, however great and mighty, so they're kind of sucking up to their boss there, has ever asked such a thing of a magician or enchanter or astrologer. What the king asks is too difficult. No one can reveal it to the king except the gods, and they do not live among humans. Here's just a little side note. The longer you go through life, and sometimes you don't have to go that long, you're going to encounter something or come across something or encounter something that there's just no answer for in the moment. I don't know what to do here. I don't know what this means. I don't know what's happening. I don't know what's going on. Daniel knew a truth, and Nebuchadnezzar is going to have to ultimately learn a truth, although it takes him a while to learn it, that there is a God and it's not me. But that God does want to be my friend. Nebuchadnezzar, his wisest advisors, do not know what to do in this situation. And when they say, we can't do it, nobody can do it, he gets so mad that he says, okay, we're going to have a couple of layoffs. All my wise men, we're now going to lay off their head. They're going to be dead. They're done. Terminated, literally. So he gives the order to the chief of his guard, go to all the wise men and kill them. That includes Daniel, who resolved to be different and let his difference make a difference. Suddenly, when he took his resolve and God honored that in chapter 1, and he's promoted to be a wise man, he's on the job for less than a year, and suddenly a memo comes down and says, hey, by the way, congratulations, you're a wise man. Now all the wise men are going to be put to death. What do you do? Again, you're going to encounter stuff in life where you don't know what to do. So what does he do? Verse 14, it says this. When Arioch, the commander of the king's guard, had gone to put to death the wise men of Babylon, Daniel spoke to him with wisdom and tact. He asked the king's officer, he goes, hey, this is kind of a curious day at the office. Why is it we're all about to be put to death? Is it something I did? Like, what's going on? Why did the king issue such a harsh decree? Arioch then explained the matter to David. Hey, here's what's going on, and here's why it's happening. At this, Daniel went to the king and asked for time so that he might be interpret the dream for him. Suddenly, he's like, why is Daniel even still alive at this point? He either took a resolve and did stuff differently in chapter 1. He should have been dead. Here, everyone's going to die, and Daniel says, hey, can I have a shot at this? Can I go to the king? Yes, go to the king. Hey, king, can I have a chance at this? Why isn't Daniel dead at this point? People were dying in front of Nebuchadnezzar if they challenged him or so much just crossed him. Here's why Daniel lived through chapter 1 and is still alive in chapter 2 and navigates this well. He had a different approach. He had wisdom and tact. His wisdom was from God, and his tact was, it was his situation here, he honored God and he honored people. He did this in a respectful way, just like in chapter 1. But it didn't keep him from being truthful and stepping up. They were true to the resolve, but they relied on God for strength. Verse 17, it says this. So Daniel then, he says, do I have permission to interpret the dream? Yeah. He goes to his house and explains the matter to his friends, Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah. He urges them to plead for mercy from the God of heaven concerning this mystery. And just in case they were not going to really pray, he said, let me give you a little motivation to pray so that he and his friends might not be executed with the rest of the wise men of Babylon. Hey, guys, will you pray? Sure. By the way, you better pray because we're all about to die. Amen. Let's start praying now. Like, they immediately are very motivated to pray. The thing is, I don't think they needed that motivation. What you see in the life of Daniel's friends is they were committed to praying and relying on God in every situation. They realized in life there is no other answer and there is no other hope. As powerful as Babylon is, there is someone and something more powerful, and that is God himself. Prayer was their first choice, not their last resort. And they relied on God, not on themselves. Hey, let's see if we can take a guess at this dream. Get rich or die trying. You better get it right. So only one person can know, besides Nebuchadnezzar, what his dream was, and that was God himself. They relied on God and not themselves. And this is the way all of us need to navigate life. Here the thing is, when God defines your difference and he empowers your difference and he uses it to make a difference, it all is on him, not on you. So we have to rely on him. It's his strength. It's his insight. It's his wisdom. It's his power that gives us everything that we need. As a matter of fact, here's what Peter, one of the disciples of Jesus, said. He said this: his divine power has given us everything we need for a godly life through our knowledge of him who called us by his own glory and goodness. You have everything you need to be who God has called you to be and do what God has asked you to do. You have everything you need to be who God's called you to be and do what God's called you to do. Everything you need. As a matter of fact, we have a memory verse every week during this series. This is the one for this week, because you're going to encounter something this week that challenges you to step back from the identity of who he's called you to be. You're going to encounter something in your life that challenges you from stepping out and doing what God's asked you to do. You're going to feel like, I can't do this. You're exactly right, but he can. His divine power gives you everything you need to be who God's called you to be, how he's defined your difference, and do what he's asked you to do, how he empowers that difference. So God reveals the dream to Daniel. He answers that prayer. He knows what the dream is. He knows what he means. And right away, he does not rush to tell Nebuchadnezzar. The first thing he does is he says, thank you. He prays. He prays to God and thanks him, because he's acknowledging, I have a different approach. This is not about me. God is doing this. And I am very grateful. And we're going to read his prayer. Listen and watch for how many times in his prayer Daniel mentions God, either specifically or using a pronoun, versus how many times he mentions himself. Just spoiler alert, in my prayers, my name is mentioned an awful lot. It's a very me-centered prayer. Daniel's was very different. Look at this. Praise be to the name of God forever and ever. Wisdom and power are his. He changes times and seasons. He deposes kings and raises up others. He gives wisdom to the wise and knowledge to the discerning. He reveals deep and hidden things. He knows what lies in darkness. Light dwells in him. 8 times already. No mention of Daniel. 8 mentions of God. He continues. I praise and thank you, God, God of my ancestors. You have given me wisdom and power. You have made known to me what we ask for of you. You have made known to us the dream of the king. 14 times as he's praying, God is mentioned. Only 4 times Daniel mentions himself. Think about your prayers. How often are you acknowledging God through worship, through gratitude, through dependence? There's a lesson here for us. We live a very me-centered life. Daniel didn't. He had a different approach, and it made a difference. So Daniel says to the captain of the guard, he goes back to him and says, hey, I can interpret the dream. Don't kill the wise men. Take me to the king. He says, all right. So Daniel says, I got the dream. I know how to do it. Take me to the king. He initiates it. Here's what the captain of the guard says, verse 24. This is an insight into what Babylon values versus what God values. There you go. Arioch took Daniel to the king at once and said, I have found a guy. Very self-promoting. He has a different approach than Daniel. Daniel is God-promoting. This guy goes, he didn't find the guy. He was there to kill the guy, and Daniel initiated everything. But this guy wants credit with Nebuchadnezzar. I found a guy. No, you found him because Daniel introduced himself and did everything here. I found a man among the exiles from Judah who can tell the king what his dream means. All right. So he brings him in. Daniel, can you do it? Verse 26. Nebuchadnezzar, again, get rich or die trying. If you get it right, what the dream is and what the dream means, you live and you're rewarded. If not, you're dead. Then the king asked Daniel, also called Belshazzar, because remember, they tried to change their name and change their identity. Are you able to tell me what I saw in my dream and interpret it? Everything is riding on this moment. This is the chance for Daniel to have a different approach and say, I can do it. I'm your guy. I can do it. What does he say? No. What? Wrong answer. Not only do you not win the prize, you're dead. And he goes on to give the exact same answer the wise men said that caused this whole memo to be issued that everyone's going to die. No. No wise man, enchanter, magician, or diviner can explain to the king the mystery he's asked about. That's the exact same thing the other guy said that made him so angry. He said, let's kill everybody. So Daniel says, no, I can't do it. But there is a God in heaven who reveals mysteries. He has shown King Nebuchadnezzar what will happen in days to come. In this moment, Daniel could have gotten rich. He had the answers, but he remembered who gave it to him. He remembered who's empowered his difference, who's defined his difference, and he said, Daniel, do not make this about you. Everything you have is from me. Who can do this? God can do this. And if you can approach any situation where you feel in over your head, any situation where you feel like, I can't do this, to have Daniel's different approach, this philosophy, to say, I can't, but God can, changes everything. Because it changes you. It reminds you of the lesson that Nebuchadnezzar could not learn. He had money, he had power, he had success, and he thought, this is all about me. Daniel had a different approach. He said, no, everything good we have is from him. And all the answers lie in his hands. I can't, but God can. That is a statement of surrender and dependence and humility that your inner ego will fight against. But at this moment, in this dependence of God, is where God uses and empowers a difference to make a difference. See, I think Daniel knew, and this is a key theme, by the way, of Daniel, for all the kings of Babylon, but really for everybody to learn, that there is a God in heaven who's in charge. There is a God, it's not you, but he does want to be your friend. He does want to be your leader. He does want to be your savior. He does want to be your provider. But he can't do that until you get off the throne and put him in charge. And see, Daniel had recognized everything good he has was from him. A lot of bad stuff has happened to Daniel. But even in all of that, he could pick out how God has provided and been faithful. He knew the truth that we read about in James 1:17 that says, every good and perfect gift is from above, coming down from the Father of heavenly lights, who does not change like the shifting shadows. God is unchanging. He is faithful. He is reliable. He is generous. But make no doubt about it, there is a God, and it's not you. But he does want to provide for you. He does want to lead you. He does want to be in charge of you, and you will fight him on that. Don't make it about you. Make it about him. He's the one that's given us everything. Breath in our lungs, opportunity, life, talents, gifts, resources. Everything comes from him. The center of myself looks to promote me, to make it about me. We have a me problem. Daniel had a different approach, and he said, no, it's not about me. My life belongs to him, and everything in life is about him. So he's constantly defining that. Last week in Daniel 1:17, he knew where his gifting came from. It said this, to these four young men, Daniel and his friends, God gave knowledge and understanding of all kinds of literature and learning. And Daniel could understand vision and dreams of all kinds. That's God's gift. He's just loaned it to Daniel. However you are gifted, however you are resourced, whatever position you have, whatever power you have, whatever opportunity you have, that comes from God. Daniel knew he was gifted, but he knew who gifted him. So he made it all about God and not himself. The things you usually do well in life, you will be tempted to do without God's guidance, strength, and help. Whatever you're good at, even if it's God designed, which it is, whatever you're good at, you will be tempted to do it without God's strength and leadership. Whenever life is going well, you'll be tempted to do life without God's leadership, provision, and you'll have a lack of dependence on Him. This was the recurring theme that people had a hard time learning, that Daniel knew well, his approach was different, and God's trying to teach those kings of Babylon the lesson. But more than that, He's trying to teach us, there is a God, it's not you, but He does want to lead your life, and He's very generous, and He's very reliable. But you will fight Him. You'll resist. So Daniel goes to the king, and he says, verse 28, your dream and the visions that passed through your mind are as you were lying in bed are these. He says, I'm not just going to tell you what it means. I'll tell you what your dream was, just like you asked. And he says, here was your dream. And he says, you dreamed about a statue. Kind of looks like this. And he says, you dreamed about a statue. The head was of gold. The chest was of silver. After that was bronze. And he kind of goes down to these different metals. At that point, Nebuchadnezzar is going, wow, what a great party trick. No, this isn't a party trick. This isn't some mind game. God showed me what your dream means. He said, Nebuchadnezzar, that's what the dream was. Here's what the dream means. The head of gold is you, because you're in charge of Babylon. The head up there is you and Babylon. You're in charge. You're the head. But after you, somebody else is going to come, and they're going to depose you as king and Babylon as leaders. And the Medo-Persian Empire would come after this, and King Cyrus would take over. And then he says, after that, there's another empire that will depose them, Alexander the Great and the Greek Empire. And then after that, someone's going to come and depose them. That's the Roman Empire and the Caesars. And then ultimately, and a lot of people debate what this last part means, but there's someone that comes after that. A lot of people think it means it's the kingdom of God. Some people think it was kind of the European mindset. But anyway, here's what shouldn't be lost here. If that's blowing Nebuchadnezzar's mind because he knew his dream, here's what should blow our mind on this side of history. Daniel's dream happened in history exactly like he said. This dream was interpreted in 603 B.C. This book of Daniel was written in 539 B.C., 900 years before they had any knowledge of the Roman Empire. How in the world? I mean, I get that Daniel knew who was coming next because he lived through it. And he wrote it after it and during that empire. But how did he know the empires that would be coming next? Because God gave him insight into the dream. And Nebuchadnezzar is blown away by it. He's impressed with Daniel, but Daniel deflects. He does not make it about himself. Here's what he says next. Then King Nebuchadnezzar fell prostrate before Daniel. He never did this. Life was about him. Suddenly, he is knocked off his throne. And he looks at Daniel and saying, you've got something nobody else has. He paid him honor. He's getting rich instead of dying trying. He ordered that an offering and an incense be presented to him. Like he says, like, we want to worship you. You're amazing. But Daniel deflects. Then the king said to Daniel, surely your God is the God of gods and the Lord of kings. Lord of kings and a revealer of mysteries. For you were able to reveal this mystery. And Daniel again says, it wasn't me. It was him. That's right. My God is the God of gods. My God is the one true God. Then in verse 49, Daniel doesn't make it about himself. He brings his friends along. Moreover, at Daniel's request, the king appointed Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego administrators over the province of Babylon, while Daniel himself remained at the royal court. Daniel gets his guys a promotion, and what they soon learn, we'll see this next week, when you get promoted in Babylon by God, it usually means there's another challenge coming. But there's also another opportunity. Another opportunity to be humble, to say, I can't, but God can. To trust that God really can provide, and that in that moment that you make it not about you, but you make it about Him. Here are three questions I want you to think about. One is, where does your confidence come from? Right now, as you encounter challenges in life, what is it you lean on to help you with those challenges? Is it your own ability, your own resources, your own wisdom? What is it you look for and you depend on to be your confidence? Secondly, who do your life and gifts promote? When you have any level of success, at that moment, do you acknowledge it's from God and do you make it about Him? Do you use that opportunity to promote Him rather than promoting yourself? And how you answer those two questions will impact the third. What kind of kingdom are you building? Like, we don't live in a day with kings and kingdoms like in those days. It happens in some parts of the world, but really, everybody's building a kingdom. And are you building a heavenly kingdom or an earthly kingdom? Is your mind focused on what God wants and letting him lead your life, or is it on what you want and building and ordering your life the way you want it to be? Those are huge battles for us. And Daniel had a different approach. And your difference makes a difference. When God defines your difference and says, this is who you are, and this is whose you are, I want you to be clear on that. And when your difference is defined by God, it'll be empowered by God. And you can truly say, I can't, but God can. And if you live like what Daniel did, you'll have a different approach. One that you make an approach of humility, of dependence. One of wisdom and intact. One that honors God in every situation, but also makes sure that you're honoring people. And we'll talk more about that in weeks to come, but it's possible to honor God and not honor people. Sort of on paper. But if you live a life where you're trying to honor God and you're not honoring people, you are not honoring God. With wisdom and tact, honoring God in the resolve, but honoring people was so important to Daniel. And that is why I think he lived, because he had a different approach. An approach that says, I can't, but God can. And when you live that way, you'll be different. And you'll make your life about promoting him and not yourself, and your difference will make a difference. What will your difference be this week? Where do you need to say, I can't, but God can? Where have you been relying on yourself or others rather than relying on God? And I want to remind you of this, and this is our memory verse for the week, and I think it's an important one. And there's a lock screen under our resources on the app and the web on the app where you can go and make this your lock screen on your phone. So on mine, it's on here. I've got it. And this is an important truth that if you can remember this in any situation, it helps you not buck up and go on. It helps you fall back in dependence on God and recognize, I can't, but God can. His divine power has given us everything we need for a godly life through our knowledge of him who called us by his own glory and goodness. You have everything you need to be who God called you to be, who he created you to be, who he's defining you to be. And you have everything you need to do everything God's called you to do this week. But here's the thing that Daniel learned. What God calls us to do very, very often is to do something that forces our hand to say, I can't, but God can. Because if I can handle it in my own strength, I typically do. God is a break glass in case of emergency. God becomes a last resort, not a first choice and not an identity. If you will live a life letting God throw you in situations that are where you're in over your head, it is terrifying. But it's in those moments that you discover who God's called you to be. Hey, we have some resources for this series. You can access them from the app or the website. We have discussion questions for small groups. If somebody missed the Sunday sermon and they want kind of the express lane version to help them get up to speed for a small group, there's message recap videos that are a brief summary of the message. There's also the memory verse lock screens. We have a reading plan that you can read a little bit daily in the Bible throughout the series. There's a number of things here for you. Our prayer for this series is that you would be different. I would be different. We would be different as we look how God used Daniel's difference to make a difference. I believe this week God will use you to make a difference. But it starts with letting him be the king, letting him be in charge, making it about him and not yourself. And when you find yourself in that moment where you can try and do it yourself, rely on others, that you choose to rely on God and say, I can't, but God can. And I'll let him be God. Let's stand for closing prayer. God, thanks that you love us and you're for us. Thanks that it really is true that there's a God and it's not me. But thank you for the wonderful truth that you do want to be our creator, our redeemer, our leader, our provider, and be the one that refines us and molds us and shapes us to be the people you created us to be. God, thank you that you're willing and you're able to define our difference and empower our difference. You'll use our difference to make an impact on the people around us. God, this week, remind us and help us live with that mindset that we can't, but God can. And God, I pray that you would use us in the lives of others, and you would teach us and grow us this week to be more dependent on you. That's a scary place to be, to give up control. But that's the place where the battles are won and where we discover your plans for our life and we make an impact on those around us. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thanks for being here. If you'd like to talk, I'll be down at the front.